Okay, Gavin's going to help me out here. You've probably all seen this before. You've probably done it before. Okay? Remember what we practiced, right? Oh, and let me move this stuff out of the way. Okay? So you've all done a trust fall, right? You know what that is? Okay? So Gavin's going to fall backwards, and he's going to trust that I am going to catch him. Okay? Then when we're done with that, I'm going to fall and he's going to catch me. No. I would squash you like a bug, dude. Okay. All right, you ready? Turn around. Okay. Keep those legs straight. You ready? Whenever you're ready. Did that scare you? Do you think I wasn't going to be there? Okay, so what was the purpose of that other than a little FaceTime for Gavin? There are times when it is really easy to trust people, isn't it? When we know the details of everything we're being asked to do, it becomes a little easier to trust, right? When we have all of our questions are answered, it becomes easier to trust. When we are certain of the outcome, right? So when we have no doubts as to how this thing is going to play out, it's easier to trust. But there are also times, and maybe these are more prevalent in our lives, when it becomes more difficult, when it's hard to trust. Right? When falling backwards, hoping that that person who said they will catch you will actually catch you. That can be more difficult. When our questions aren't answered, or when we are still uncertain about the outcome of the situation, it can be hard to trust. When we are asked to do something out of the ordinary, or to do something that goes against the normal routines and the normal grain of life, it can be hard to trust. It can be hard to trust when we are scared about the thing we're being asked to do, or being asked to trust in, or to have trust about. So fear creeps in, and we can have difficulty in trusting. The second key that we're going to talk about today, the second key of Christmas, is this idea of trust. That we can trust. We can trust God in all situations and at all times. We have probably experienced some fear this year, right? We have, and still are, facing unknown virus, loss of job, loss of income, an uncertain election, racial unrest. Even the vaccines that are coming out have some people a little fearful because they don't know what's going to happen when they inject that into their body. On a personal level, you may be facing other situations that are producing fear inside of you. You might have things going on in your life that leave you unsettled, that life doesn't seem to be right because there's this something that's going on inside, something that you're facing in life that you're a little scared of, and it causes you to lack trust. And so the question before us tonight is, at Christmas, can we still trust? Or maybe you're in the camp where you need to trust for the first time. Can we do that even when we're scared? And the Christmas story tells us that we can, because we see it in one very special person who plays a very, very big role in the whole narrative of Christmas. We see that we can trust through Mary and what she did and how she lived out her role in the story. When we meet Mary for the first time, it's believed that she is a 12 or 13-year-old girl. Now, we have a lot of our students in here. How many of you are 12 or 13? Okay. Okay, Joe and Michelle, she's betrothed to a man probably 7, 8, 10 years older than her right now. How's that feel? And how would that feel for you? Speechless, right? I know. It's crazy, right? But that was Mary. She was betrothed to a man named Joseph. Now, the word betrothed, we don't use it anymore. It's kind of been replaced by engagement. But it was more strict than engagement. It was more binding than an engagement. Right, ladies? You can break off an engagement and then go to the pawn shop and hawk your ring and make some money, right? No, I'm kidding. Back then, you couldn't do that. Because when someone was betrothed, it was a legal, binding document and arrangement that had been made. The groom's family, the bride's family, they had come together. They had said, our children are going to get married. The bride price had been paid. All of that stuff had been taken care of. They were now legally bound. For all intents and purposes, when we encounter Mary at the beginning of the Christmas story, she is married to Joseph. That is why in Matthew's account of the Christmas story, when Joseph finds out about the pregnancy, he says, or it's said about him, he went about trying to divorce her quietly. The reason he had to divorce her is that in that legal system, they were technically married. As part of their betrothal period, the woman would live with her family, the man would live with his family, and he and his father would build a room or a couple of rooms, an apartment, something, onto the family house. Once that was done and the father said, okay, son, it is done, he would go to the woman's house, they would get married, and they would immediately consummate the marriage. So during that betrothal period, they didn't live together. There was no physical contact. That's how things went back then. And that's the state in which Mary and Joseph find themselves when we are introduced to her in the beginning of Matthew and the beginning of Luke. Mary was just like any other Jewish girl or Jewish woman. She followed in the traditional steps of what it meant to be a Jewish woman. Like all other Jewish women and Jewish girls, she prayed that she would ultimately give birth to the Messiah. It was the longing of every Jewish woman's heart to give birth to that baby boy who would be God's chosen one. That's what they prayed for, that's what they longed for, that's what they desired deep within them. And while Mary was blessed to be the chosen one, right, the one that God used to bring about the Messiah, the way in which he went about doing it was not what she had planned, was not what she wanted, was not what she had been praying for, right? Her prayers did not go anything like this. God, make me the mother of the Messiah, and if you can do it in the most outrageous and crazy way possible, that would be super. No. She just wanted to be the mom of the Messiah in the natural, normal way with Joseph as the dad. And it is not crazy talk to say that what happened to Mary was, in fact, crazy. The angel announces that she is highly favored by God. The angel says, you're going to have a child, but it's not going to be by normal means, Mary. The Holy Spirit will come on you. And you will give birth to a son whose name is Jesus. And he's not the deliverer in the way that you think. He's not going to free you necessarily from Rome, Mary. He's going to free you from your sins. Picture yourself in Mary's shoes. You're young. Your future is beginning to be laid out before you as you have taken that first step of womanhood and you are now betrothed to be married to Joseph and begin your life as a normal Jewish couple in this little town called Bethlehem, or called Nazareth. You are a virgin And now you are told that you will become pregnant through supernatural means. How in the world are you going to explain that to anybody, let alone Joseph? And in accepting this call upon her life, she has risked her reputation. She has risked her future marriage. She has even risked her life. Because the law said if she was to be found unfaithful to Joseph, she was to be stoned. She was to be killed. There would definitely be a certain level of fear that she would have experienced. And yet, from her response, we don't see that fear. Because her response is simply, "May it be to me as you have said." She says, "I am the Lord's servant." Meaning, I'm allowing myself to be used in any way that God deems appropriate and fitting. Whatever God wants for me, no matter how difficult, no matter how trying, no matter the risks to my life, no matter how scared I might be, I'm the Lord's servant. And she trusted in this God who called her to an outrageous thing. And we see her trust in Luke chapter 1, 46 through 55. You want to turn there? We're going to read these verses in just a moment. But these verses are what's called Mary's Magnificat. It's Mary's song. It's Mary's song of praise, of worship, that happens after the angel comes and tells her what's going to happen. Here's what Mary says in her song. Verse 46, Luke chapter 1. And Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. For he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He's brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, just as he promised our ancestors." From Mary's song, we see her trust and we can draw things from it that help us understand how we too can trust, especially in the face of difficulty and of fear. The first thing is that she focused on God and not the problem. Did you notice as you heard those words or as you look at it now, how many he's and his are listed in there? This song is all about God. Who he is, what he's done, what he's going to do. She focuses on him, not the situation. She focuses on what God is able to do. She recalls what God has already done, and she looks forward with trust to what he will do. The entire song is about him. She recognizes God is in control of this entire thing. That if this is the call he's placed on her life, she trusts that he is going to not only give her what she needs to get through it, but she is going to lift her up in the meantime and in the process. Never once does she mention the problem. Never once does she mention the situation. Never once does she say, "Woe is me." Never once does she complain. Never once does she do anything about the situation. If we were to read this psalm independent of the Christmas story, we would have no clue that Mary has just been asked to do this amazing thing. We would just know that she loves the Lord her God. And she trusts in him. I think one of the reasons we fail to trust is that we sometimes focus too much on the problem. We fret and we worry. We dream up every conceivable solution only to run into roadblock after roadblock. We let fear take over. It robs us of sleep. We get stressed because we have tried to solve it so many times and we have found no way out. We are still in the midst of the hurt and the pain and the fear. Now, I am not one of those who puts Mary higher than she needs to be or deserves to be or actually is. I think there were moments that Mary had that were some anxious times because she was human. But we're not told that here. She doesn't give us any indication of that. Nowhere does it say she let the situation control her, take her over, or run the show. She simply trusted because she focused on the God who had the solution to the situation. And she didn't focus on the problem. Mary also knew her place and position. Mary was humble. Now, true, it's a bit ironic, right? Because she says in 48, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant, right? So, okay, if she calls herself humble, doesn't that kind of negate her being humble, right? It's like, you know, I'm a very modest person. Okay, well, you just said you're modest. That kind of promotes you as being not modest, right? Anyway, but she is a humble person. And trust requires humility. In part, humility is the understanding that I am not capable enough, gifted enough, smart enough to figure the problem out and to know what to do. And when I can see that in myself, it better enables me to trust in the abilities and the gifts of the person who is smart enough, who is capable enough, who does know what to do. When I know that I can't, but that God can, I can trust Him to do what only He can do. There was nothing flashy or proud about Mary's response or about her life. She was a normal Jewish girl doing normal Jewish girl things, looking forward to a normal Jewish girl life. Her words to the angel were not self-promoting. They were not proud. She simply said, I will do what God has asked me to do. As I said, she refers to herself as the Lord's servant. Now that word servant, it's not, you know, Jeffrey the butler kind of servant. All right? It's the word for slave. She called herself the Lord's slave. She looked at God as her master, meaning I do what He tells me to do. I am at His disposal. I serve Him regardless of what He asks me to do. So maybe, if we have trouble trusting, maybe it's not so much the trust, maybe it is that we have a pride problem. And that what we need to see in Mary, and one of the keys to Christmas, is that the trust requires humility. To trust requires being humble and depending not on my abilities, not on my gifts, not on my talents, but depending on God. And recognizing that whatever He asks me to do is in my best interest, it is for my good, and that He's going to walk the road with me. Mary also saw the bigger picture. She understood that what she was going to go through, yes, there might be some pain, there might be some shame, there might be some weird looks from people, but that on the other side of that situation was glory and rejoicing and celebration and praise. Not only did she not focus on the problem, she actually looked beyond the problem. She looked beyond the discomfort to see the beauty of of what lay ahead for her. There is this sense of awe and amazement that we find in her words, that God had brought this honor, but the end result will not be her pain or her hurt or her suffering. She calls herself a blessed person. How many times have I been in a situation that I felt scared or I felt uncertain or I had trouble trusting? How many of those times did I say, boy, I'm really a blessed person? Most of the time I look at it and say, God, why? Why are you doing this? But not Mary. She recognized God had done and was doing great things for her. This would be one of those great things. And she says, praise His name. She's not the only one to think this way. Jesus, as He grew and as He began to minister, He taught this very thing. At the end of His life, right before He goes to the cross, He's got the disciples around Him. And in John 16, He says, guys, guess what? I've got some news for you. You are going to face difficulty in this life. You are going to suffer. But He doesn't leave them there. He follows it with a big but. But I have overcome the suffering. But in me there is good on the other side. Paul picked up on this in Romans 8. Paul wrote, we are children of God, we are co-heirs of Christ, if we share in His sufferings so that we might share in His glory. You see, folks, in many ways, glory doesn't come if we don't go through the suffering. As awful as that is, as painful as that might be, Scripture seems to say glory only follows the suffering. And that's what Mary experienced. To trust is to endure, to thrive through the uncomfortable, to thrive through the hurt, the ridicule, the unrest, the rebellion, knowing that glory resides on the other side. It is the idea that we feel blessed to suffer for His name. That's what happened to the apostles in Acts. The first part of Acts is the apostles getting in trouble with the Jewish authorities. Right? They're in the synagogue and they're teaching people about Jesus and they're pointing their finger at the Jews saying, shame on you for killing Jesus, right? All this stuff. And the Jews don't like it. The Jewish authorities, they don't like it because it makes them look bad. And so they throw Peter and John and they throw the disciples into jail. And they want to do something worse to them, but they end up just flogging them or beating them. And then in Acts 5, they're set free. And the apostles look around at one another, and I can just picture them. They got these smiles on their faces, and they're high-fiving each other. And it says this, they counted themselves fortunate, blessed, that God saw them worthy to suffer for His name. I'll be honest, I've never uttered those words. And yet here they are, flogged, beaten, imprisoned, threatened with death. And they thought of it as a good thing. They were praising God that He saw them worthy enough to go through that. We had the slightest little difficulty come into life and we get mad at God for not taking it away. Mary has been blessed. Some take that too far. But Mary has been blessed. God has lifted her up. And she is now praised because she lowered herself in humility. And that's the key to Christmas that we find in Mary. Looking beyond the suffering and receiving the glory. And then the last thing is that she recognizes God's provision. Verse 53, she says, God has filled the hungry with good things. She understands that God has provided for him, for her, for his people. When we trust, we are saying that we know that God will give us what we need when we need it. We looked at this a little bit last week as we recounted Israel's history, right? From the time that God called Abraham and set the promise before him, all those ups and downs, all those years, all those instances where they thought and then it fell, and all this stuff until finally when Jesus was born and God fulfilled his promise, God provided every step of the way. Until ultimately Jesus is born, the Messiah comes, and Israel through Jesus becomes this blessing to the world, to all the peoples on earth. Even when Israel rebelled and disobeyed him, God provided. Even to the point where when Judah goes into exile under Babylon, God goes to him and says, okay, look guys, come here. Nebuchadnezzar, you know, the big meanie on the other side of the river. Yeah, he's going to come. He's going to take you over. Okay? But here's the thing. I'm not going to leave you. In 70 years, I'll come back for you. Now, we chuckle at that. And they may have chuckled at that. But the fact of the matter is, in 70 years, God went and got them and brought them back. Because even in their rebellion, even when consequences were due them, he provided. He met their needs. He did what he said he would do, and he enabled them to do what he wanted them to do. And so no matter your situation, no matter what troubles you, God calls you in. He says, okay, come here. Yeah, this is going to hurt a little bit. Yeah, this is going to be uncomfortable. Yeah, there's going to be a little suffering. But I'm going to walk the road with you. I'm going to provide what you need. I haven't called you to this to leave you on your own. I've called you to this to show you who I am. You see, Abraham trusted. David trusted. Mary trusted. And in verses 54 and 55, that is what she remembers at the end of her song. God promised, they trusted, and God provided. And what it says to you and to me is he'll do the same. No matter what he calls you to, no matter the difficulty you're dealing with, God promised, we trust, and he'll provide. The word trust is defined as reliance on the integrity, strength, and ability of someone else. Mary was asked to do an incredible thing, an amazing thing, a crazy thing, something that threatened her very life, and something that had the ability to produce great fear in her. And she could have said no. Right? She could have said, angel, can you, you know, give me a day? I got to think this through. And then come back and said, yeah, you know, this really isn't in my life plan. Right? This isn't how I saw things going. So I'm going to continue with my plan. But thanks for asking. It's nice to meet you, angel. Right? But she didn't. She simply said, I'll do what God wants me to do. She took the key and she unlocked a great truth for us. And she trusted. She kept her eyes on God. She humbled herself. She held on to the truth that there's glory on the other side of the suffering. And she waited on God's provision. She relied on the Lord's strength and ability and integrity. And at Christmas, God calls you and me to do the same. Let me pray for us. Father God, thank you for people like Mary, who when asked to do these amazing and crazy and supernatural things, trusted you enough to say, Here I am. May it be to me as you have said. In spite of the fear, in spite of the suffering, in spite of the unknown, they trusted and let you do what you do. And so my prayer for us at Christmas is that we see that in the birth of Jesus and in the way in which he was born through Mary, we might learn to trust as well. We might set aside the pain. We might set aside the fear. And call upon the stories of Abraham and David and Mary to see how God promised, how they trusted, and how God provided. In the name of Jesus, we pray.